My name is Abu Abdullah Al-Habshi. We don't need any democracy, we don't need any communism, we don't need anything like that. All we need is Sharia.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, just in case you thought that was another moron just sprouting terror and threats, we're going to show you a photograph now of this guy, and it's a bit obscure, but there are the decapitated heads of Syrian soldiers, other Muslims almost certainly, but they've been beheaded. And it's important to realize we're not speaking of some sort of Tudor 16th century beheading. These people, that their heads are sawn off effectively as they scream and beg. And one would have thought that cutting the heads off children, burying people alive, subjugating, humiliating entire populations would not be such an attractive prospect. But ISIS is gaining recruits throughout the Western world. Author, journalist, and associate director of the Henry Jackson Society, Douglas Murray, joins us now from London. There have been quite a few from the UK, quite a number from Australia, France, elsewhere. What's the appeal?
Well, it's quite a lot of things. First of all, I suppose there's that type of person who thinks that life in a nice, safe, liberal democracy is kind of boring and is attracted to the fight. Then there are those people who are more driven simply by the opportunity to be sadists of the worst kind somewhere in the world. But all of them have, to a greater or lesser degree, an ideological sympathy with the fanatical Islamist achievements and aims of ISIS and groups like them.
Mm. Now, I don't approve of, but I can understand someone who feels, I don't know, some sort of empathy or solidarity with Palestine, people who went off on either side of the Spanish Civil War, not approve, but maybe understand. But in this case, it's such a strange ideology that believes in killing Turks, Iranians, Syrians, everyone else who doesn't completely agree. But it is recruiting not just a handful, but a number of people. And if a dozen or 100 are willing to go over there from the Western world, we have to ask, what is their support? It must be the tens, if not hundreds, of thousands.
Yes, I mean, one of the most terrifying things about this, I mean, I'd sum up in the following statistic, which I don't think anyone other than myself has sort of been focusing on, worried about. We have in Britain a drive to recruit more Muslims into the British Armed Forces. You can't get an exact figure, but around 500 Muslims serve, thank goodness, in Her Majesty's Armed Forces. But an extraordinary fact, which, as I say, really ought to be focused upon, is that more people, more British Muslims, have joined ISIS than have joined the British Armed Forces.
Incredible.
It's an absolutely astonishing fact when you think about it. More people want to go and behead their fellow Muslims and kill people and torture people with impunity in Syria and Iraq than want to join the British Armed Forces and take part in operations which actually, in recent years, have repeatedly saved Muslim lives. There is a real problem that Britain and other Western countries are facing, a real problem of integration and a real problem over winning the hearts and minds of young Muslim populations.
That is an incredible figure. I haven't thought about that. To put it in some sort of perspective, it's not a neat comparison, but the British in Ireland, and again, I can see both points of view on that particular conflict, always a huge number of Irish Catholics and British people of Irish Catholic descent in the British Army, enormous number, far more than ever wanted to be part of the IRA. This is something which I don't think we've ever seen before. We're going to show another clip here, and there are so many, by the way, we could show, of other Westerners, and people need to remember education, healthcare, human rights, tolerance, a wonderful pluralistic life in the Western world. However, apparently this is not what is required. Have a look at this clip, please.
This is a message to the brothers who stayed behind. Wallahi, ya ikhwa, you need to ask yourselves what prevents you from coming to the land of Izzah. What prevents you from joining the ranks of the Mujahideen, those that spill their blood to raise the raya of La ilaha illallah, to raise the raya of Tawheed? What prevents you from attaining martyrdom and the pleasure of your Lord? Look around you while you sit in comfort and ask yourself, is this how you want to die?
Now, I'm older than you, Douglas. I remember when South Asian immigration really was taking place in the UK in the, I suppose, early to mid-60s, or at least the mid-60s when I was aware of it. There was certainly racism. People were coming from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Hindu, Sikh, Muslim, a few Buddhist and Christians as well. they weren't always treated the way they should be. But if we look at what's happened now, the Hindu community, assimilation's not the issue. The Hindu community is overwhelmingly law-abiding, part of the middle-class fabric of British society. Sikhs who probably suffered more than anyone because they were so visibly different, the same would apply. It's Islam, it's South Asian Muslims who had the same experience, and not all by any means, but so many have become radicalized, and as we saw, are willing to go and kill in the name of their religion. What can be done about it, if anything?
The most important thing, Michael, the most important thing that can be done is a concerted effort to undo the lies. To undo the lies that a generation and more of young Western Muslims have been taught. Of course, not all of them have imbibed it, but a very significant number have. And these lies are across not just local politics, but across geopolitics. As you point out, it was mainly from the Indian subcontinent that British Muslims arrived. So what is Palestine to them? Most people who arrived after the Second World War in Britain from Pakistan and from other countries, they didn't care about so-called Palestine. They weren't het up with a grievance about the Jews and this. These are things that have been taught to them, a sense of grievance that has been inculcated in them. And it is satisfied and it is fed by politicians, by community leaders, by religious leaders and others who think that they can feed a bit of this lie to them and that'll not cause very much harm. And it does cause harm. If you are across your society implying, for instance, that the Israeli Defense Force, instead of trying to carry out one of the most targeted and precise military operations in military history, is in fact engaged in the genocide or massacre or ethnic cleansing or even Holocaust of Palestinians, you are feeding the lie. If you claim that British and American and Canadian and Australian forces in war zones like Afghanistan are not in fact protecting Muslims and trying to make sure that a democracy is possible in that benighted country, but rather that they are there as oppressors, as haters of Muslims, as people who are murderers and war criminals. If you allow that rhetoric to go on, you feed the sense of injustice, you create the sense of grievance. And I think that's why this is something which across our societies we have to think about more clearly. What are the things, the lies, that are allowed to go on from the top of society down, which feed into this grievance that means that young men from Britain, Canada, America, Australia and elsewhere think that they should join a group which is frankly, and I always say it's horrible to reach for the phrase, but the nearest thing you can think of to this kind of behavior is the SS during the Second World War. This is an extreme Nazi ideology that they're joining. And yet something about our societies is losing the battle for hearts and minds for some of these young people.
That's so eloquent, so well put. And I would again remind viewers, we mentioned South Asians in the UK, North Africans in France, Turks in Germany. It's not about ethnic background. The recurring perennial theme is Islam, given a radical interpretation by leaders, not all Muslim, by the way, in the past 20, 25 years, and the result is quite horrific. Douglas, always such a great pleasure. Thank you so much, my friend.
It's a pleasure.